I'll be speaking about the features that are available in Cluster, just something to do with file system. So anyone who's not interested in file systems would probably not attend the talk. If you're interested in cloud computing, you're very welcome to join and ask questions. My name is Niels de Vos. I work for a company called Red Hat. Most of you probably have heard of the company. And my role at Red Hat is being a maintainer of NurseFS, the LinkedIn upstream project where I work on. I help with debugging problems in customer deployments. So anything related to NurseFS, I'm mostly aware of what you said try to. And surely the latest features that we have will be presented now. So during this talk, I will give you an introduction, a quick start with some examples of how to use Cluster, how to deploy it. I'll tell you a little bit about the stable releases that we support. We support multiple releases because the storage solution isn't the easiest and people are a bit scared of losing. I'll tell you about the recent features that have been added in the current releases, but also the features that we plan to add in the upcoming releases. And I've picked a few features that I'll discuss in a bit more detail. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to interrupt and ask. We have my microphone over there, by the yellow pullover with staff on it, can run around and turn the microphone at you. So don't hesitate to ask if there's anything unclear. Out of interest, how many people have heard of Cluster before? Nice. How many people actually tried it out, not only read about it? Yeah. And how many of you use it actually in production? Okay. That's a tendency of letting go, but that's fine, it's cool. So, okay. So I'll give you an introduction about how Cluster works. Not everyone has heard of Cluster before, but most of you do. I'll explain you a bit how the basic functionalities are supported. So, Cluster is a scale-out file system. It's used in cloud environments. So if you have a lot of data, you can store this on Cluster. If you have data that doesn't fit on one single server, you combine many servers together, you put Cluster on one of those servers, and you have one huge file system that you can use. In addition to that, you can have replication and other things, so your data is pretty safe even if on a server is not available at the time. You can access your data through different methods. We provide a fuse daemon, which is basically a user space process mounted to Linux kernel fuse environment, and this provides you with a POSIX complaint file system. So all the applications that you already have and are already running on local file systems, you can just run them on Cluster. If you prefer object storage interfaces like APIs, Swift, or similar, you can use this as well. Applications need to be adapted to use object storage in such a way, but enough current applications actually use Swift or similar. We also have a library where you can use your own applications to speak native Cluster protocols. This library is called GF API or libGF API. One of the examples is that Kingdom uses libGF API and you can pass a specific Cluster URL to Kingdom. You can pass Cluster colon slash slash one server name slash volume name slash file. And Blister knows how to integrate this URL and how to use innate Blister protocol without going through a fuse mount point or NFS content. We currently don't use any metadata servers. We use some metadata to keep track of changes and other things, but we don't have a central metadata server. It means that we don't have the bottleneck of a central metadata server. There are file systems or other distributed solutions that use a single metadata server or a single active metadata server with some backups. But these metadata servers tend to be a single point of failure or at least a bottleneck in some circumstances. We don't have a metadata server at all, so we don't have these kind of bottlenecks. This can be used on any hardware you like. So enterprise customers, probably by Dell, HP, or any of the other vendors, with maybe up to 16 disks in one chassis, they probably would put a RAID control on some of them in servers, and even just for those. At home, my middle environment where I have all my RPMs and repositories, I use a 30-minute ARM environment, which is completely opposite of an enterprise solution, but it works just as well, at least for my use case. So you can run it on practically any hardware you like. Blister is very flexible. You can scale it the way you like. So you can scale it up, you can scale it out depending on what your needs are, how it's going to work on the thing. In a Blister environment, because you have many servers, the data is distributed and you can have many clients connected. One server only supports a number of clients. Say that one server supports 200 clients. If you had another server, you should have two servers, means you would have 400 clients to support, or you could support 400 clients. If you had more and more servers, the resources become bigger, or you have more resources available, and you can also support more clients. So, scaling out and the number of clients is very useful, especially in the HPC environment or content delivery networks where you have many servers and many clients. A little bit about the structure in Blister itself. We use bricks. Bricks is basically a storage unit that we talk about. It is a file system mounted in some directory, somewhere on your storage server. We suggest to use XFS because that's what we test most, and XFS supports up to at least 500 terabytes without any issues in a single file system. All the functionalities in Blister are implemented as a layer. This layer is called a translator. The translator is put on top and implements a certain functionality. For example, if you want the Blister NFS server, the NFS server on top is a translator. It speaks NFS protocol on one side and it speaks Blister translator on the other side. On the other side, you put down of the NFS translator, you implement the functionality like distributing or a replication of data. And all the functionalities that we implement in the Blister are translators. You can build a whole list of translators and each specific translator addresses one particular functionality. So you're very flexible. It's like a building block to write a file system, a building block for custom storage environments if you want to. So it makes it very easy to prototype new ideas, to add a very new, simple, or complex functionality without affecting the rest of the code base. These bricks, those directories in the storage servers, if you combine them together, you create one cluster volume. This cluster volume is the file system that the clients will start to use. So the clients will mount these cluster volumes through fuse, through NFS, on a use it through the Dimjet API, and this is the access point where you put your data. In Rust, we speak a lot about peers. A peer is pretty unique name compared to node. Some users call everything node, but we don't know if a node is part of the cluster environment or if a node is a file system. And we need this distinction to help users with it better. So we call everything a peer if it is a storage server. So a group of peers together creates a trusted storage pool. This trusted storage pool is like a cluster, so to say. If you repeat it a lot, then it's really difficult. So to say cluster, it's getting confusing. So we call it a trusted storage pool with that. It's a bit longer, but hopefully it's easier to browse. Alright, if there are questions about the technology, the difference between scale out and scale up can be of importance for how you want to use cluster. Scale out is adding more servers. This is basically what you do if you have not too expensive servers, which is what you probably want to use for cluster anyway. So a server with just a few CPUs, a RAID chassis with maybe up to 60 disks or something. And even though that's already a pretty big server, but you can buy much more powerful servers with I don't know how many CPUs and many, many disks. Those servers are obviously more expensive and don't build up the distributability of your data that much. So we suggest to use many smaller servers instead and scale out whenever you need. So you would add another server if you run out of space or close to out of space, and you keep on adding servers with more disks. The scale up way would be to buy initially a huge server but not fill it up completely with disks and RAM. When you need more performance, you can scale up and add more RAM, add more CPUs, add more disks if you want to add more storage, but most users will do the scale out method, especially if you are using cluster in a cloud. It's much easier to add more virtual servers than to actually add resources to existing servers. One of the useful things, because well, we say we are a distributed storage environment, is a distributed volume. A distributed volume combines those bricks on different servers together. The client will mount this distributed volume and will use or files stored on either of those servers. The client knows or can calculate the location of these files. So all of the clients know the file name they want to open, because that's what the user interface of a file system is. User interface of a file system is directories and file names, at least the initial access. So we use this information, because we always have this information from the client, to calculate on which brick the file is located. So when you have a distributed volume, you create a new file. This new file in cluster gets calculated to a hash value, and each of the bricks have specific hash ranges assigned. So the client knows, okay, which brick has which hash range. The file name hashes to this particular value, and we'll put the file on this particular brick. Another client that is not aware of the file yet might want to read this file. So the first client has created the file, the second client wants to read it. The second client knows the file name. It can create a hash out of the file name. With this hash value, it can see, okay, well, which brick has this hash range? So which brick do we need to contact for this particular file? And that's basically the whole trick of distributing data in cluster. It's done on the client side
which prevents the need of any metadata server. So the client does not need to ask one of the metadata servers, where is this file located? Which is the case what you do with PNFS, for example. With PNFS, you have a metadata server. The metadata server says, okay, this file is located on this particular server, or this part of a file is located on that server. That means that the NFS client needs to talk to the PNFS metadata server. Connection goes back. The client then connects to the right server that actually has the data. With cluster, we can save this step, and we also save on the metadata server needs. So the client calculates the location of the file and accesses through the brick directly. Any questions about distribution?
Yeah? So how do you manage that if you want, you say, fail is catastrophic? Is there then a way to replace on, say, server 2 on the fly without telling the client to stop?
If
you have a metadata server, you can move your data from server 2 to server 3, and then the metadata server.
Yeah, okay. So I can repeat your question. So the question is, with, for example, PNFS, you have a metadata server. The file is located on one server, and you can move this particular file somewhere else. You just move the file, you instruct the metadata server, okay, update your metadata, the file is now located somewhere else. With cluster, that's not the case because we don't have a metadata server, right? That's your question. So what we do, we give each brick fixed hash ranges. We normally don't relocate files from one server to another. If you want to remove an existing brick, you can do so. The hash ranges will get updated. And the client will then know which hash range is for which brick and will know where the file is located. In the unfortunate event that when you have a distributed volume and one brick is missing for whatever reason, maybe a network outage or anything else. So this is not a very typical use case because it's a bit simpler. But if server 2 is completely missing and file number 3 would be created, then the client says, I want to put file number 3 on server number 2. The server is not there. Instead of completely failing the operation, the file will be created on server number 1. So the file name hashes to the brick on server 2. The next client would not be able to find it, even though the file exists on server number 1. So for these cases, cluster has a fallback. If the file isn't there, it does an additional lookup. And the lookup says, OK, which server has this file? And then the client knows, okay, instead of on server 2, this particular file number 3 is on server 1. It will also create a empty file on server number 2, which basically is a pointer to the file on server number 1.
Okay, it was exactly my question was more like server 2 becomes very old and it has a billion files. And mm-hmm. you want to empty it somewhere else on the fly and replace it by new hardware and put all the files back. So that was more the situation.
Yeah. So you can deprecate bricks or remove bricks. All the files on those bricks will get moved out to the bricks that are available. Then you can safely remove this particular brick. For example, if you have a server issue and the server is not running stably anymore, you can say, okay, this brick is going to get removed. Move all the files to the available bricks. Once that process is done, you can just turn off server number 2, add new hardware, and yeah, put it that way. So yeah, you can do those things. And there is a fallback in case the file is located somewhere else. So that's, yeah. Okay? Now, we have the distribution. Distribution is a very important thing for the scale-out functionality that we have. The other functionality that is very basic for a cloud file system is replication. You don't want to have your data only once, because, well, if one server fails, you can't reach the data on that particular server anymore. So we have a replication mechanism, And this is called automatic file replication. What it does is that whenever the client mounts this replicated volume, upon mounting, the client actually gets the whole volume layout. That's the same for distributed volumes. But for replication, the client knows which bricks should be copies of each other or mirrors of each other. And it then will write the file to both bricks at the same time. So it's a synchronous replication. The writes only gets acknowledged when both writes happened. Or timeout. And in that case, healing will happen later on. So now we had the distribution and the replication. Because Gluster is based on translators, as I mentioned before, you can put those translators together and you can make a distributed replicated volume. So you have one layer, the orange bar is the distribution layer. This distribution layer speaks to the next translator, and in this case, the next translator is the replication translator. There are two replicated volumes, and in total, we have four bricks. So combining the functionality of these two together, we can build a distributed replicated volume. If we want to add more storage, we would add more servers or more bricks in pairs of two, because our replication factor is set to two in this case. So actually, cloud storage is pretty simple, right? Any questions? Oh, yeah?
Yeah, what I was wondering is mainly about the distribution translator. How does it handle balancing the amount of data that goes to which server? Will it do that dynamically? Will it like change the hash range for servers dynamically if the disk fills? Or is manual balancing required? That's what I was wondering.
So, okay, so there is no automatic rebalancing. Files are placed on the pretty random hash value that gets calculated based on the file name, which means that all the bricks are more or less equally used. In case one brick, for example, one storage server has more drives than another, and you build a logical volume out of it, or anywhere else. That means that one brick file system can be bigger than another, and we actually account for that and adjust the hash ranges for those bricks accordingly. So if you have one storage server that has twice the storage space, and you have another storage server which basically then has half, then two-thirds of your files or the hash ranges will land on the big server, and one-third will land on the other server. So, yeah, you can also do that after the fact, after you created the volume. So if for whatever reason you want to increase the brick file system instead of adding another brick, you can actually rebase or rebalance the whole volume, and the data get migrated back and forth, and the hash ranges get adjusted and everything. So you can do that. It's very similar to how adding additional bricks. So that's available. It's not automatic, it's manually. These things do tend to take a lot of resources, especially network IO. If you transfer terabytes or maybe even petabytes of files, you probably want to do that in some kind of maintenance window, or at least the time where your customers aren't on their peak usage. So I already mentioned a little bit of how you can use Gluster, how you can access the contents. So the main way of accessing Gluster is over Fuse. So you mount the file system as a fuse file system, the user space process will then handle all of the requests that come in from the kernel. For more traditional solutions or broader use cases, NFS is used a lot, especially on Linux and other Unix servers. NFS is available in two ways. We have NFS version 3 through the built-in Gluster NFS server, and we have NFS Ganesha, which is a much more advanced NFS server. It's a user space NFS server and builds on libgf API. For Windows users, there is a libgf API based plugin, and Samba uses this plugin to provide access directly to the volumes of subdirectories of the Gluster volumes. You can run your Samba server on the same storage server where you run Gluster, or on other servers that are dedicated for that. The Swift on File project, you can find it on GitHub, I think, is an object-based interface. It implements the Swift protocol and is part of the OpenStack environment. You can also use it standalone. You don't have to use OpenStack if you want to use Swift on File, but you still need some of the OpenStack components. This is built on libgf API with Python bindings. So this is a very efficient way of doing object storage. Other users of libgf API are Kemu, Berios. We work a bit together with the Facebook folks, and they provided a tool called GlusterFS Core Utils, which provides you binaries like GLCP. GLCP is the normal CP binary, but it accepts Gluster URLs. So you can actually use user space copy, cat, put, I think they have ls, and you can use those commands without mounting anything. If you want to run Gluster clients inside a container, then these utilities might be very useful, because you don't need to mount anything. You don't need root privileges or any particular kernel functionality. We have packages available in Fedora, Debian, and NetBSD. So we're very proud on having the NetBSD. It comes from a completely non-Red Hat contributor. He's working very hard to make sure that we don't break NetBSD support in Gluster every now and then. He finds a lot of bugs that get exposed in NetBSD, and these bugs even could sometimes happen on Linux. For whatever reason, they don't happen, but he finds them on NetBSD, and obviously we fix them if he doesn't send a patch. We are also part of the storage SIG, the special interest group from the CentOS project, and we provide Gluster packages there, so anyone running CentOS can easily install Gluster. We also provide more versions, sometimes even different architectures, on download.gluster.org, so anyone who wants to use Gluster can go there. And we have several quick start guides. So depending on your operating system, some things are a bit different, for example, the installation on Gluster. So I'll show you a little bit of how to use Gluster and how to install it. So this is just a simple test server. It's a VM on my laptop because, well, that's obviously the easiest to test. This is a CentOS 7 system, and to install Gluster, I would do can do yum install CentOS release Gluster if you would have network.
Thank you.
So for anyone not familiar with how CentOS release packages work, these provide a yum repository. This yum repository file gets placed in the standard yum repository directory, and it makes the Gluster repository available for any further usage. So you install this package. And after that, you should be able to install it. But well, that's with live demos always the case, right? Okay, so we'll try to download 4 megabytes. Well, that should be possible. So what I've done is I enabled the Gluster repository. I've installed the GlusterFS packages. I start the main Gluster management daemon. And now I can use Gluster pool list to see, okay, if we have any other servers. This is the basic Gluster functionality that we have. It's one server. That's not very interesting, of course. Well, something seems to be missing. So you would do a Gluster peer probe of the other virtual machine. If, like now, this is failing, we can use a single host environment just to show how things work. It's not very interesting, but it can show the technology anyway. So in this case, it's a bit ugly because I only have one server, but all right, we can do it like this. We can make 2 bricks. In this case, it's on the local file system. It's not very nice. It's one server, but we at least have a volume. So we created a volume called FOSDEM, and it has 2 bricks. These bricks are actually on the local file system because my laptop doesn't have the power to host many disks, so I just use the local file system. And it's a distributed volume. It doesn't do any replication. We're on one server anyway, so replication really would not make a lot of sense. And now we can mount this volume. So this actually runs through the Fuse binary and everything, ties in the user space daemon with the Fuse kernel module and we have a file system of size 14 gigabytes because, well, that's the size of each brick combined. So this is the really basic functionality. If you have multiple servers, you should make sure that your firewall allows connections and things like that. I'm not going to check that now for the other server, but that's most likely one of the things I forgot to turn off. So that's how you can easily use it. You can store your virtual machine images on it. You can put your pictures on it, anything you like. You can distribute it over multiple servers and everything. For the basic functionality that we've shown, so the quick start, well, that's more or less what I showed you. At the moment, we don't have any plans to change that. We maintain three releases concurrently. So we have the 3.7 release, it's the most recent release that we support, the 3.6 release, and the 3.5 release. These releases get bug fixes and small feature changes if they are not impacting of anything else that is already available in the release. So we don't want to break anything. We keep everything that functions when the release was released. We keep it functioning, and we can add some small features if that's really what users want. Otherwise, users need to wait for the next release. The 3.5 releases, if there are any bugs reported and bugs fixed, we do a release around every 10th of the month. So there's a monthly release cycle for all of the releases. The 3.5 release didn't get an update, I think, the last 2 months because no one reported any bugs or sent any fixes or other improvements. The 3.6 release still gets quite some maintenance burden, and patches and bugs get fixed there whenever needed. The 3.7 release is very active, and I think two releases back, we had about 64 patches that got applied in 1 month, which is rather much, but there are some feature improvements, and some of the features that were introduced in 3.7 were not completely considered stable. So these features were then improved, and they tend to get some more work. The 3.5 release already include many features not everyone is aware of, but they're very helpful. So we do some snapshotting of QCOW2 files. If you have QCOW2 files for VM images, we can do efficient snapshotting. There is GFID access. GFIDs are basically the inodes in Gluster. If you want to open a file based on the inode or GFID, then you can actually do so. Sometimes you have error messages in logs mentioning this particular UUID, and then you can actually see, okay, which file is it, and what should I do with it? We added compression, quota. Read there is made much faster. Zero fill, so if you want to create an empty file with and completely pre-allocated, there's a very efficient operation called zero fill, and it's done on the back end. So instead of sending a lot of writes with zeros over the network, you actually send one procedure, and the back end allocates all those files zeros for you. If a brick fails, the brick failure detection got improved. And we have parallel geo-replication. Geo-replication is the multi-data center asynchronous replication, and making it parallel improved performance really a lot. 3.6, so the previous release, added better support for SSL. The different sizes of bricks, the question we got earlier, if bricks are different sizes, then the distribution logic now actually accounts for that and places more files on bigger bricks and fewer files on smaller bricks. GlusterD improved with volume byte logs, so that if you do a operation on a volume, not everything got blocked, and you can actually do multiple operations on different volumes. which means that your monitoring, which sometimes for certain operations requires a lock, can actually run concurrent on different volumes and doesn't block or doesn't completely error out if it times out. We have volume snapshots, which are also user serviceable, which means that a user can mount a snapshot if the admin allows that. And users basically can travel back in time to the snapshots of their data in case they changed something and need to see what it was before, or have to restore files or anything. RDMA improved, and we also got a huge contribution from Data Lab in Spain, and they implemented a translator. So I've explained about the replication translator. This translator is similar to a rate 5 over the network translator, disperse, it's called, and is doing erasure coding. In 3.7, we introduced even more features. 3.7 was released May last year. We improved the performance for a lot of things, including small files. Small files have a lot of overhead for their own metadata. So if you update a small file compared to the data that you actually want to get out of the file or want to write to the file, the overhead is pretty big. So that use case, for example, for mailboxes or web applications or similar, performance got improved. We support tiering. Tiering makes it possible to put hot data on, for example, SSDs. You build basically an SSD volume. You build a normal SATA volume. You put the SSD volume on top of the SATA volume, and the hot files, the files that you just create, land on the SSD. If you read files enough that are actually located on the slower SATA drives, these files migrate to the SSD drives, and reading becomes much faster. When you don't read them often enough, those files automatically move back to the SATA drives again. So that's the tiering concept, and we introduced that. We're working on improving it more and more, and also improving performance, so that will be coming in the next releases. Users, especially Windows users, are very used to having a trash can or trash bin or recycle bin or whatever it's called. In Gluster, we have a trash translator, and this translator actually catches all the delete operations and places those files in a .trashcan directory. So anyone that deleted a file is able to recover this file. So a lot of these features, including the tiering and the trash, are optional features. You don't get them immediately. They are disabled by default, but you can enable them, and usage after that is completely transparent. The same goes for bitrot. Bitrot is detection of bad drives. So sometimes you write your data, you don't read it a lot or often or at all. And especially for archives or backups, it's very important that your data is still intact. But if you don't read it, you don't know. And sometimes some drives, especially the now bigger drives, they tend to get more errors because you have more data on the same drive. If 1 terabyte gives a number of errors or is expected to give a number of errors, if you put more terabytes on one drive, the number of errors per drive goes up as well. So it's getting more and more important to be able to detect errors. Not all errors are detectable by the hardware itself. So it can be that you wrote some data to a file, but once you read it back, there are some bit flips. That can happen. It can happen due to a cable, it can happen due to a bad drive, or even a chip in the mainboard or the firmware can do that. But it can happen, and it's not always detectable by an error message. So bitrot signs data and compares those signs again. So this way you can actively detect if data got rotten some way or other. We have an internal feature that's called the upcall framework. Upcall makes it possible to instruct, for example, cache invalidation to clients. If one client modifies data on a place, we can instruct other clients to invalidate their caches. This is a very important feature that we added for example, NFS Kanisha. NFS Kanisha is a user-based NFS server and requires this kind of functionality, otherwise you would get stale data or stale file handlers or other weird errors from your NFS server, and you don't want that. I haven't spoken much about it, but if you have two copies of your data, it is possible to run into split brain scenarios, which means that if one side of your environment is down, the other side of the environment is still up, you modify your data in the up environment, which is fine. That's not really a split brain. Well, it's temporarily a split brain, but it gets resolved as soon as the downside gets up again, and it knows that it has old data, so it will resync everything that's modified. That's a fair solution. That works perfectly fine. But if you have network issues, it can be that clients think that one side is up, the other side of your client, or other clients think the other side is up. And if they modify the same files, you don't know which file actually should have the right content, or should have the right content, or has the right content. And this is a typical split brain scenario. As Gluster, we cannot merge these two files back into one. We don't know which file you want. Maybe the contents need to be merged. Maybe you want to have the last version. Maybe you want to have the biggest file. That's not the decision Gluster can make. What we suggest is use three copies of the file. As long as you have two copies, then you know that this is the right data and this is one copy. We don't allow writes if you're in the minority, so these two copies are always right. That costs a lot of data, right? So you need three times the data to store one file. Well, you want your high availability, so you actually only want two copies. So we added an arbiter functionality, which is yet another translator. And this arbiter creates empty files. This allows you to create three replicas, one of which is completely empty, so it doesn't cost you storage. But it still counts as a copy in case one of the servers goes down. So you still have the option to see, okay, which version is the right one, and restore the server that was down or the network side that was in the minority. So this is a very efficient way to have or to prevent split brains without adding the third copy and the third storage array. This is a lot of use for virtual machines. For virtual machines, we also added sharding. Sharding enables you to distribute the load a bit more. I'll have a slide about it as well. So I mentioned a bit about Bitrot. So Bitrot by default, it's disabled. You don't normally want to do inline Bitrot detection, which is an extremely expensive operation, calculating checksums of what you've written on data. When you read data, calculate the checksum, compare it to whatever is there, that's a very expensive operation, so you don't want to do it. So we do by default a periodic scan, and we complain loudly in the logs if something is incorrect. Sharding is very interesting for huge files. So if you have VM images, you probably want to use sharding. Shards make it possible to distribute the data over a number of servers. Normally we do the distribution per file. Sharding actually splits this huge file into smaller files. And these smaller files get then distributed over the distribution translator. So basically the same thing as what was happening with normal files is now done with smaller files, but it's not seen by any of the applications that use Gluster. It's done automatically, hidden well away. actually wanted to show this, but we're a bit running out of time. So if you want to see something like this, or if you have more questions about it, come to see me after the talk, or go to the Gluster booth. We're in the K building next to the FSFE, right of them. So especially if you are interested in virtualization workloads, the Overt guys are there as well, and they really want sharding, or they use it for their use case too. So NFS Kanisha is a user space NFS server. We tend to deprecate Gluster NFS, which is an NFS version 3 server. We don't want to implement all the features that NFS has in our NFS server. We just want to use NFS Kanisha, and we help the community evolving the project there. For 3.8, which is planned May, June timeframe, we add more support for tiering, so that tiering is more flexible. Lots of other nice goodies, and lots of improvements. We're very active. We have lots of developers with awesome ideas, and not all of these might actually land in the 3.8 release. We're trying hard to get everything implemented, but we're not sure yet if we can actually implement all of these features. Some of them are rather tricky. 3.8 is also a preparation of multi-protocol support, so that you can actively use Gluster through Windows, through NFS, at the same time. There are some difficulties with that, because access control lists, users, and other things don't always match up. The logic of locking is different on some of the Windows environments than it is on Linux, so we actually have to accommodate for all that. So we need to add a lot of features. These are the details for version 4.0. We'll include some of the bits in the 3.8 release, and mark them as experimental. Users can optionally use them and try them out and see if it works, report their successes and failures to us, and we'll try to improve everything more and more. I'll just skip these, and if you have any questions, if you plan to use Gluster, contact us on the Gluster users list. Many of the developers and other users are actively responding to ideas on how to deploy Gluster for your particular solution, and we can give you a lot of hints and suggestions on what the best practices are. So feel free to contact us, ask us if what you're planning to do, if that suits Gluster, and let us know how you deploy your environment. That's it. Thank you very much for your attention. So I got some stickers. If anyone wants a sticker, you can come and visit me. I'll be going through this door out. Thank you.